that we're facing and that we're addressing, and it's dealing with our St. Mary's Villa, which is located in Humboldt. It's an issue that's not new to us, but it is one that we're having to move and work through quite quickly. It involves Dust Wing, which is a portion of or a section of St. Mary's Villa. This part of the building was constructed in the 1970s and was designed initially to manage and work with clients that required level 1 and 2 resident care, so quite a bit lighter care. Over the past 5 years, problems with sheet lino, so flooring, has been experienced, and that lino has been repaired, but it hasn't been sustainable. So if you walk into the building, you see noticeable repairs on that lino. Over that same time period, code requirements have changed, and the types of residents that have been cared for in that facility have also changed quite substantially from when that building was constructed. And we now are becoming increasingly concerned with the flooring structure, and recently commissioned an external engineering consulting review. The review came back to us, and we've only received preliminary results, and we're advised that there is not imminent safety issues, but there is concern for our residents and staff that the flooring is gradually deteriorating. I have to have a drink. And that this floor is deteriorating, and that our residents would be better served in different part or different care environment. So we take these concerns seriously. This is not where we want our residents to be cared for, and so we're going to move on these concerns quickly. The plan that we have for going to move will impact 10 enriched housing clients and 32 residents of the Dust Wing. Our intent is to begin this dialogue and planning immediately. And what we want to convey is that we really appreciate how hard this is to our staff and the residents and the families that we serve. So we'll open it up for some questions.
Sandra, the major issue seems to be of how it was handled in getting the word out. We've heard from family members of the 10 supported living residents. We understand that this subject was initially broached yesterday at lunchtime when staff told people in the lunchroom that they were going to have to move, but there was no details given in writing, lots of questions unanswered, and they're not going to hear anything more until 6:30 this evening at the meeting.
Yeah.
Can you speak to that?
Yeah, for sure. So the report that we commissioned came back, and we made the decision very quickly because it is a safety concern, and it's not an issue that, like I say, it's not an imminent danger, but it is a safety risk. And so you take those concerns, and before we put a plan that's, you know, all the T's are crossed, we thought, let's go out to the community and work through developing the plan together. And when you do that, you have the risk of not having the plan all in place. And so the first line of communication was to the staff and the residents and the family to say, here's the problem, now let's work on the solutions together. So that's where we're at today. The decision was made on Tuesday. We started that communication yesterday. We've come to you today to bring the issue. We're going out right away to start meeting one-on-one with the families and the residents to work through the next steps. So we'll work through that plan one-on-one with those residents and the enriched housing clients.
Some residents have said that the end of March is the effective.
Yeah, we'd like to have folks moved as quickly as we can. To make the plan work, we have to start with the folks that are in the enriched housing. And that is the space that we'll start to move some of our residents into. We also have beds available in the other parts of St. Mary's Villa that we can use. When we started to have concerns around the flooring, we started to not admit into beds that were available in other parts of St. Mary's Villa. So we have some vacant beds in other parts of the villa that are available.
When did you start to admit?
March 31st?
No, we haven't set the date. We'd like to move as quickly as we can in a way that's respectful of the residents that we have to place.
Are you saying that the residents, the 10 residents in the assisted living, will not there by the end of March?
So the folks that are in the enriched housing are our clients, and their needs are very different than the residents. The residents that are in the St. Mary's Villa are level 3 and 4 care. Okay, so they're folks that need to stay in the villa.
But specifically about the enriched housing
clients.
Clients.
Yeah.
And
they need to be moved first into other housing.
Do you have a deadline?
No, we don't have a deadline.
Some of them have been told March 31st.
No, well, they're the first folks that we have to move.
But you say you have some rooms for them? No, not for them.
We have
for those 10?
Not for the energy.
No.
You don't have any rooms for them inside the villa?
No, not in the villa.
And is there any way that you think that you can compensate those people for they have to move?
So what we'll need to work through is alternate living accommodation for them. We're hoping that we can place them in the community, or certainly in places that are close to where they're used to being living in Humboldt or surrounding area. Again, we'll work with them and their families. There is options open in the community that we know of. And then we'll start to work with our residents. And like I say, there is a room in St. Mary's Villa for all of our residents.
Yeah, but do you think that those then is going to have to move can hope that they're going to have some money compensation for that?
We will assist them, yes, to make that transition.
So what kind of care do they need? Like what kind of place would they need? And is that available around there? It's probably...
There is availability.
So what care do they need, like those 10?
They're folks that would require minimal, they don't require nursing care as such. Like they may be home care clients. They don't receive care. They may receive food assistance right now.
So they're not the, they need to have a nurse or they
that's
need to
right.
be looked after
yeah.
24 hours a day.
Yeah, that's right.
So are they a little bit easier to find care for
that's
than,
right.
than the others?
Yeah.
And have you had any concerns from people? Have you, like you're just starting to work with families now?
Yeah.
So are you hearing all these like, where are we gonna go? You know, this isn't, you know, we came here hoping that this would be, you know, our place to live and
yeah, it's tough. Like, and those discussions will just get underway. Like, this is their home. We respect that. We understand that. So we'll start those discussions now with them.
Some of them said that they got the feeling that you're not going to explore any possibility inside the villa.
Yeah, there won't be room for the enriched housing clients in the villa. The beds that are available in the villa will be required for our residents. That we do know.
How many beds are there available right now for those
groups? For those folks, there is enough room for the clients that we need to move, or for the residents that we need to move.
All 32 have a space already.
That's right, yeah.
Wait, there's enough room for the 32 if you move the channel.
That's right.
Now, you said that you would assist them in making the transition. We've been told that the residents have been told that the health region will subsidize the difference between the cost of living at St. Mary's Villa and living at a more expensive alternate housing. Is that true?
We will make some accommodation for a time period, yes.
For 1 year, I understand?
We'll make some accommodation, yeah, with the families to have that discussion.
Pardon me?
We'll have that discussion with the families.
So it could be different for each family depending on
we'll have to have that discussion with them. On an individual basis, yeah.
So that hasn't started yet. Is that starting tonight?
That starts tonight.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is this a temporary move? In other words, when the floor is repaired, will the assisted living clients be able to move back in?
Yeah. Right now, what we need to do is get everyone placed. Then that'll allow us to start to work on our long-term strategy for St. Mary's Villa. And we have not began that strategy yet. We're just, like I said, made the decision on Tuesday. We need to get everyone to a place that we can then begin to work on the next step.
So how many care homes is there in Humboldt for senior people?
Well, this is the largest care facility, yeah.
But how many others?
In Humboldt, this is the largest, yeah. This is the one that, yeah.
Yeah, but you say that those people can go at other places, so how many other people?
This is the only care facility of this type, but enriched housing is a very different care level. So there is many other options available for folks. So in Saskatoon, for example, we have like like Luther Towers would have enriched housing as an example. So like Parkview downtown would be an example. So people have like an apartment, they receive their meals in an area that, you know, with assistance.
And there are those available to people?
There is, yeah. And it's a, you know, it's a service that you pay for that, yeah.
Sandra, if you're talking about the linoleum, why not just move someone out of the room, replace the flooring, move her back in, go down the halls?
Yeah.
Why do you have to move everybody off the unit?
So what became obvious is that it wasn't just the linoleum. So when we started to look at this 5 years ago, it was a linoleum replacement, which we were patching. And then we saw that, you know, this isn't the only issue. So we started to look under the linoleum, and it's a much bigger problem. It's the trusses underneath. The structure that is there is a wood structure. So it's a wood on dirt.
Are they rotten?
It's becoming unstable, yes.
Well, you have problems with other things in the future?
No, the other structures are concrete.
So is this an add-on at some point in the 70s?
It was its own structure in the 70s.
Oh, so it was first and then the other ones were
added? Yeah.
So it's becoming unstable. Do you know will you ever move back into?
We won't move back in its current state. We won't move back in its current state. It'll either have to be totally redone or rebuilt. Like that structure will not be used as it is.
Are there any other services or facilities in that wing that you're not going to be able to replace these loops? I mean, those are the dining rooms, for example, on the map.
Yes, we won't use that. We won't use those facilities in this.
Do you have backups for these things, though, or is there anything you're going to not have a backup for?
I'm not understanding.
Like, how big a disruption will this be?
They'll be able to move.
Getting rid of a dining room and a sunroom, and you know, this big of an area, like how much is this going to impact the whole villa?
It's a considerable disruption for the staff that they have to, that will work around. But the plan, there is room to rework through this, I guess.
So how long do you think the works going to be there?
I think they've put together a great plan. The staff have worked really hard in a short time to
a month, two months, to do this.
Oh, it's not a simple fix. Like I say, it has to be either reconstructed, like rebuilt or reconstructed, and that's where we have to go next.
So do you know yet if you were actually going to rebuild?
No, we don't.
And so you're really having to, at this point, figure out if you are going to rebuild, where the money's going to come from? Are you at that stage?
We're not at that stage, no.
No, the boiler under dust wing is the one that failed. And we understand that was replaced. Mm-hmm. Was it replaced under dust wing?
Yes.
So are you saying that there's a new boiler in there in a wing that may never be reconstructed? Yeah,
but it does heat the building. Like, it's not solely for that structure. It heats other parts as well. So it's not a throwaway infrastructure, I guess.
So why are the residents in enriched housing having to move somewhere else, where the ones in the dust wing are just transferred?
Yeah.
Why is it the other way around?
Yeah, that's a good question. So the folks in enriched housing, the clients that are there, they're not of a care need. They're there for housing, an important service that's provided. But the residents are residents. They require intense service that we provide. And that service isn't offered in other places in the community. This building is required for that service. So we need that building to provide that service. It's staffed, it's built for that service. The enriched housing clients, we can find services elsewhere for them, and we will find services for them in other parts of the community. So that's why we had to make that difficult decision.
So the enriched housing it's a part of the St. Mary Villa, except they don't need the care.
Yeah, that's right.
So it's just kind of on the side.
Yeah, that service is, it's not one we offer in many parts of our region. It is quite unique to St. Mary's Villa. Yeah.
So would it be fair to say then that this could be years before you figure out how or if you're going to replace the enhanced living area of St. Mary's?
Don't know. No, don't know.
Well, it sounds like you're making the point that you don't do enhanced living generally as a health region. And so Does that mean it's unlikely that you ever would get back into the enhanced living bed?
We offer many different services for clients. Many of these clients will receive home care from our service offerings. So we serve these clients in different ways. It's the housing component that we typically not involved in. So,
with the aging population in Saskatchewan, increasing numbers of older people mm-hmm. who are needing different levels of care, does that make it especially urgent or important to the health region to maintain the 32 beds in Dusling to rebuild, to reconstruct that? Or is there any chance that wouldn't be rebuilt and that the number of beds in that facility is just reduced by 32?
The number that we need is very consistent. Like we need those beds in that community. It's not like we're looking to reduce the number of long-term care beds. So we're going to need to work through this. And we're moving these residents into rooms that are going to be shared facilities again. And that's not what we desire as well. So we're moving back into two-bed units.
And so are you talking about the current assisted living facility has like a bedroom and a sitting room, and that'll turn into two beds?
That's right, yeah.
So you have some three beds. Mm-hmm. So everyone has their own room.
That's right.
And so that's going to change.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So will it be about this about 30 people then that we'll have to share, or will it 40?
No, there's different combinations because there is rooms yeah. in the villa, other parts of the villa as well. So
some people are going to have to share now,
yeah.
and some will still stay in the single room.
Yeah. And some are sharing in other parts of the villa as well. It's not all privates throughout the villa.
Oh, okay, so there's already some
yeah.
sharing
going on.
Okay.
Yeah. So you have to start in the dust wing? No work from
no, not immediately.
Are you going to have to do any renovations to the part of the building that's now enhanced living before you move the long-term, the higher-level care people there?
There is a few minor renovations that need to be done. We need to reinstall the nurse call, have it fully functioning. We need to put a tub room back into place. And then the rooms need to have just minor modifications so that they're ready for the residents.
Do you explore
those can happen very quickly though there.
Have you looked at the rest of the building to make sure is there inspection done, anything like that, to make sure there are no other issues? It's obviously the second fairly major issue that's
yeah.
place.
Yeah, well this building certainly has had its major share of challenges. And because the building has, you know, it's been built in stages, that each part of that building is very different. Mm-hmm. So it has undergone many different reviews, and that's part of its preventative maintenance that is undergoing and underway all the time as well.
What are the preliminary cost estimates of this?
There is none. And like I said, this was a preliminary report that came to us that we're working off of now. So the final report will be due to us in the near future, and then we'll start working off of that.
So are there any of the flooring problems? So it's been deteriorating for the past few years. So this was there anything new discovered? You know, once there was the whole carbon monoxide scare, like was there something discovered with the flooring through that?
No, the two aren't linked.
Yeah, separate, no.
So it wasn't when they went into the boiler, right?
No.
Found anything?
No.
Is there asbestos in that unit? In that wing?
You know, I don't know. That's nothing that's nothing that is exposed, I guess. That's not something that we're dealing with.
So that wing for now will just kind of sit empty until you figure out if...
That's right.
So it may get renovated, may get replaced, or it may just never get knocked down, I guess.
Well, something will have to be done with it, yeah.
Can I just revisit? Are the 10 assisted living residents, do you intend to have them out of there by March 31st?
We will need to accommodate and work with themselves and their families in a way that's progressive, because they are the key to working with our residents to move forward.
So on a calendar, March 31st, is that the deadline by which the families, those 10 individuals, by which they have to be out? Yes or no?
Yes, like that will be key.
So March 31st is the deadline.
Yeah, I'm sure that is probably what we're gearing.
Now, about this help with the cost of transition. I understand that it costs about $900 a month to live at the assisted living facility at St. Mary's.
I'm not sure what it is. Yeah.
Okay, you're not sure if it's $900. And residents have been told that they will be subsidized by the difference in the cost between that and the new place, such as Kaylee residents.
So, like I said, we will work through each of these individuals as we go through this, as where we will be helping them be placed on an individual basis.
Is it true that 1 year is the limit?
Again, we'll have to work through this on an individual basis.
That's not a yes or a no?
That's right.
So I guess for now, are they being told like this will be a permanent move? That,
At this point, we need to, work with them too. Well, some of them have been there for years. This has been their home.
How will this affect your staffing?
That we don't know as well. We really have just started to work with staffing. And
maybe I would just go back to the point Sandra made about how early we are in the process. We did not come with all the I's dotted and T's crossed because we really believe that both working with those families and the community will benefit us in knowing how best to serve them. And that's why, as we answer your questions about do we have all those answers, we don't, because it's really important that families work with us. It's the same with the employees. Yesterday when we met with them, it was really important that we asked for their help. And, many of them have solutions that we had not thought of. And that's why we have those conversations. So although March 31st is where we're looking to have people move, if in fact solutions come forward that look different, we are open to any and all solutions that both have the residents safe, our employees safe, and be able to move towards a transition for everyone. So I think same with employees, we need to make sure we engage them. And we don't know what it will mean for staffing, but we'll work with them and our unions to make sure that we can accommodate everyone.
What are the options in the community? You said you're aware of options. What are they?
Again, we'll go person by person, depending on what they are. I think when we work in a region, there's many different care models. There's many different, and fortunately, Humboldt is the size of community where there is different options available in different care home settings, in different home settings. So,
but often there are waiting lists for housing facilities for
old people. So, there was sort of a quick scan of what was there, and folks in the community were confident that there was opportunities that we could start to work with. So. But I think, you really have to work with the families now, because they'll have to review those options and it'll be a very individualized decision. If you're faced with that, that's time for a discussion.
I mean, is it conceivable that some families, some sons and daughters may have to have mom and dad come to live with them?
I think everyone has to have a discussion and we'll work through that with them. They're very deserving of that discussion. It's a very complex level of care. So they may be cognitively impaired, physically impaired. Many of these folks would require very total nursing care. So assistance being fed, lifted, toileted, dressed, fed, very basic needs. Yeah, full-time care. And that's where, it's interesting how something as basic as a structure of a building has changed. You may not have required something like wheelchairs when that building was designed. Well, now everybody may require a lift. That bed was something very simple. Well, now you have beds that require full lifts to accommodate people. And the poundage, the pressure put on that floor to accommodate a patient or to care for a patient is so intense that it really changes how the building is used. And over time, who would ever have anticipated that that would have changed in such a way?